Okay, so hi everyone. Welcome to this live stream today looking at work-life balance. And just before we get started, I'll mention a couple of things. Everyone's on mute today, so if you do have any questions or any points that you want to say, you can use the Q&A function. And that is just a little question mark in the top right of the screen, so you can write anything that you'd like to on there. If we do get any questions, then I'll choose a few to answer at the end of the presentation. And if you do see any questions that are already up there that you want answering, you think, oh, actually, I'd like to know the answer to that, then you can actually use a little like button and we can choose the most popular ones to answer. This is a live stream, so if you want, you can pause and come back to it later. And we are being recorded, so you can listen to it again if you want to. My name's Annie. Just to let you know, I'm a health advisor who's based in London, and my background's actually in nutrition. But in my role, we sort of like to focus on positive lifestyles to promote health and well-being. So today we're going to talk about, if we move the slide onto the agenda. Perfect. So we're going to have a look at work-life balance, a little bit about digital detox, on the flip side, how technology can support us a little bit, and we'll also look at how we can improve our sleep. So first of all, we'll look at the work-life balance. And I'd like to say, getting the right balance between work and leisure can really be a challenging thing, and it's for lots of different reasons. Now, Londoners actually spend about 3 weeks more at work a year than the rest of the UK, and with an average sort of working week of about 40.4 hours for males and 35.2 hours for females in London, it's really important to strike the right balance between work and leisure. Now, with current guidelines, we are potentially working from home a lot more. It can disrupt our typical routine. It might lead us to go one way or the other. So we might procrastinate a little bit more when we're not in our usual office surroundings, when we've not got our work uniform on. Or we might be really productive, but we might be more inclined to work longer hours or over the weekend, just because we've got our laptops and work phones on at home. Something also worth mentioning is that many of us are now part of this thing called a sandwich generation, which is a generation of people whose caring responsibilities span two generations. So, for example, you might be caring for your children, but you also might be caring for aging parents or in-laws. And for some people, things like being self-employed or running your own business can really add to that pressure. You might also find that you're responding to client and business requests outside of traditional business hours, or you might find it hard to switch off and separate your work from home life. I think working outside of usual business hours is also really a lot more common, and it's just because the world's more connected. So you might be working across different global markets and therefore time zones, or you might be delivering goods around the clock. Now, why is it important? Having a really good work-life balance is recognised by NICE. So that's the organisation that gives guidance about health and social care. And it's recognised as being really important for mental health. So NICE encourages workplaces to support work-life balance through policies. And as a good balance can protect both our physical and mental health. So, for example, I think worth mentioning, it might help to protect against high blood pressure, maybe drinking too much alcohol, maybe depression. And if people do look after themselves and achieve a good balance, they'll be more productive and less likely to experience burnout. Now, I think really important to mention that you need to find out what works for you, because it really will be different for everyone. Some people work intensely and really thrive off the adrenaline, whilst others might prefer a bit more of a structured working day. I know that's me. I like to have everything laid out and organised and be really, really structured with my day. And also, I think if you are in a managerial role, you will need to be mindful of how your work behaviours can impact the team. So that might be scheduling early morning meetings or sending emails late at night can really set a precedent for the rest of the team to do the same. So when reviewing your work-life balance, really essential to consider external factors. So it might be your relationships, your family commitments, and if you are getting pressure from your other half, so people may be saying you're always checking your work phone, you're always busy, it might be time to readdress things. If you are feeling a bit stressed or overwhelmed while you're working, really can have that significant impact on both your personal life and your productivity. And I think best to seek support from your manager before you reach a point where you can't cope, as you might be able to make some small changes to your routine that could be the solution to problems. So let's next have a look at some tips so that we can try and help us get that right balance. Now, although we are potentially working from home more, it's different for everybody. We can still use the hours that we're working, either from home or out and about, to look at how we can get that work-life balance. So I've mentioned it briefly already, but I think really important, do try and get that support from your employer. Discuss your workload with your manager. Do let them know how you're coping. Try and manage people's expectations of what you can deliver and when. And if it is possible, have regular meetings or one-to-ones. I do know that we're spending a lot of time probably on Zoom or Teams, but really, really good to get those one-to-ones in with your manager. I know that they help me just to have a catch-up and see where everything's at. You can also talk to your manager about working arrangements. So depending on the nature of your role, you might be able to have maybe a flexible working hours or compress your working week into a set number of days. And if you are working from home and looking after children at the same time, then flexible hours might be beneficial for you. Now, I would also like to say, try remember to use your annual leave. You are entitled to it, so do use it. We often think that we need to go away. We need to use our annual leave to go on a holiday, which is obviously quite difficult at the moment. But I think really it is important to have a break and try not to think about work. At the moment, I'm usually using my annual leave to book a Friday off every couple of weeks, just finding that a long weekend really, really helps me to just have that time, a little bit of a break. Also, try remember that saying no is okay. So learn to say no if you can't take on any extra work or responsibility. Do make sure you're able to explain why though. You can't just say no without a reason. And do try and accept the things that you can't change and concentrate on the things that you do have control over. And again, linking that back to regular meetings or meetings with your manager. These are things that you can discuss with them. We want to try and stick to our contracted hours. So see if there are ways that you can work sort of smarter rather than harder or longer to achieve the tasks that you need to do within your contracted hours. I know it's not always possible. I know that we do work longer some days, but maybe that means that another day you can work half an hour less. Try and develop good relationships with your colleagues. So it can really, really help to create a social network at work. Particularly important now as we are sort of spending more time social distancing, not in the office. I'm going to try use whatever you can really just to check in with each other. So maybe that's email or Skype. And your work colleagues know the work that you're doing, so it can really help you to stay focused and motivated. I know that it is, or it can be a bit hard over Skype, having our meetings or having catch-ups, because we don't always pick up on the social cues that we would do when we're in a room with people. But I think really beneficial to try and keep up with sort of social things like that if you can do. I want to mention as well, if possible, try and find a specific working area. Some people are lucky to have an office area, others might not. I'm at the moment, when I'm working from home, setting out just a section on the kitchen table. It makes me feel a little bit more productive, and obviously I'm not having many visitors at the moment, so any bit of mess isn't as much of a problem. Alongside all of these tips, I will say do try and be aware of the signs of work-related stress. Almost 12 million working days are lost each year because of perceived work-related stress, and it can contribute to conditions like anxiety or depression. Nearly 500,000 people in the UK have work-related stress at a level that's making them ill. So some of the signs include feeling that you can't cope, constantly worrying, finding it hard to concentrate and remember things, maybe feeling disappointed with yourself or lacking in confidence, and seeing only the negative things in life. Now, I do know that we will probably all feel a little bit of those things at various points, but if you are noticing that that's quite constant, then do try and have a conversation with somebody, whether that's your manager, a GP, and try and get that support there. So if we move on to the next slide, we're going to have a look at what we can do after work hours. So it's on the other side of the work-life balance. So while we are at home, we do want to try and make that conscious effort to achieve a good work-life balance and try and stick to it. So we want to try set a few non-negotiables, which might be different for everybody. So for example, we might want to try and set a bedtime. So set our bedtime is non-negotiable. I'm going to bed at 10 every night, or something along those lines. So particularly when many of us are working from home, it is important to set times and boundaries for when you will work and when you will relax. It does seem strange to set a time for relaxing. It makes it quite structured, but I think it is important. We want to try not to think about work when we're not working. So if you are spending time with your family or doing something that you enjoy, try to put any thoughts or worries about work to one side. Again, can be quite difficult sometimes, but just throw yourself into that leisure activity that you're doing. Spending time with family and friends outside of work is a little bit tricky at the moment. We do need to make sure we're sort of observing the correct social distancing measures. And depending where you live, there might be stricter rules than others. So it might mean that we are getting creative with how we're socialising with our friends and family. It might be video call apps that allows us to catch up from our own homes. It might be playing board games with people that you live with or online games with friends. Setting up leaderboards or game leaderboards to give everyone just something to look forward to and a bit of competition there, or friendly competition, hopefully. Now, although we might need to rely on technology a lot more at the moment, do try to spend a little bit of time without it at home. So really important, switching off from Facebook, emails, Instagram, TV, just for a little bit of time can help to relax our minds. And for those working long days, it can be hard to find time to incorporate exercise into the working week. So whether that's working from home or not, when we are working from home, it is easy to forget to do our usual exercise routine, or maybe our gym classes aren't running, or you might usually exercise with friends and you're not maybe allowed to do that at the moment. This is why we might need to, again, get a little bit creative with what we do. So it could be looking online for free classes or videos, utilising household objects to make your own gym. I know a lot of people were doing that towards the beginning of the year. You can look on sort of Bupa health blogs, and there's some exercise ideas, or maybe YouTube, just to give yourself some ideas of what might be good. And finally on this slide, we do want to try and eat a balanced diet as well. Loads of fruit and vegetables and get enough water, stay hydrated. We do want to try and keep our bodies healthy and hydrated and try and find time to enjoy our meals too. So moving on to the next slide. This is something that we sort of touched briefly on just on the last slide, but worth mentioning again. There is a lot of information going around about the pandemic, and while it is really good to be up to date, probably not that great to be looking at Facebook or Instagram to get all the advice, just because we don't know what's right and what's made up. So I think just be aware of your existing habits with technology, and try and think about how they might impact the information that you see as well. So you might want to think about setting a time to not look at your phone or turn notifications off for a specific time in the day, and just sort of give yourself a little bit of a break there. So onto the next slide. Humans are social creatures, This is sort of on the flip side of the one before. So it is really important for us to have positive social interactions, and it can really help to combat loneliness and stay upbeat as well. So if you are having to use technology to stay in touch with people, then a few sort of suggestions of things that we could do involve video apps, which I've mentioned before, WhatsApp group chats, so you can stay in touch with people. You can actually also send voice notes as well, so you can hear people, their actual voice down the phone, even if you're not in a live phone call. You can also look at apps that are sort of designed for good mental health, really. So the Headspace app, so it's really designed to help you train your mind, your body, for a healthier and happier life. Or maybe something like Calm as well, which is another app. If you are sort of a sporty person, or you're looking at keeping track of your exercise, you could track your heart rate or steps with things like Fitbits, or on your phone as well. And if you're a bit more sporty, you could look at Strava, where you can compare with people and connect with people and compare all the exercise that you do as well, which is great. So moving on next, we're going to have a brief look at some information surrounding sleep. Now, sleep is really, really important. I think when we're trying to get that good work-life balance, we look at our work, we look at our leisure time, and I think that sleep is definitely included in that. So with sleep, it's set up into different phases. So the first phase of sleep is called non-rapid eye movement, NREM, and that's how you spend most of your sleeping time. So this phase within that has three different stages. The first stage is N1, and it corresponds with feeling drowsy. N2 is the sort of light stage of sleep, where you can really easily be woken up. And it's actually how you spend around about half of your sleep time. And then N3 is that period of deep sleep. So usually if you've had a good period of deep sleep, you wake up feeling a bit more refreshed. Now, the second phase after that is your rapid eye movement sleep, which is REM. And that's the phase where you sort of tend to dream. And with sleep, it is a cyclical process. So the sequence that we just mentioned, going through the phases, occurs repeatedly throughout the night. And a cycle lasts sort of on average about 90 minutes and occurs around about 4 or 5 times a night, although it does depend how much time you do sleep for. So on to the next slide, we're going to just look at how we can try and get enough sleep. A couple of little tips here we'll go through. So first of all, I'm going to just mention that we want to try and resist the temptation to snooze. I'm definitely guilty of hitting the snooze button, but in that sort of groggy state when we wake up, it just gets really easy to hit that snooze button. But it is likely though that delaying your alarm won't just make you late for work, it'll also leave you feeling worse once you're up and out of bed. And the reason for that is your body actually begins preparing you to wake up sometime before your alarm goes off. So it releases hormones that promote alertness and getting you ready to face the day. So hitting the snooze button actually confuses this process, as those sleep promoting hormones are released into your bloodstream, making it even more difficult to wake up. We want to try avoid caffeine. I'm sure people have heard this before, but it is really important. Caffeinated beverages sort of late in the day have been shown to prolong efforts to fall asleep, as well as negatively impact your sleep quality. So even the really healthiest sleeper, even if your sleep is good most of the time, should be really careful with the amounts of caffeine that we're ingesting. Now, while we are familiar with caffeine in tea and coffee, chocolate bars and soft drinks, I just want to note that caffeine can also be a hidden substance in some products like medication. So if you are on any medication and you're struggling to sleep, do just check the ingredients of them. We also want to cut down on alcohol in the evening. So alcohol actually might ease you getting to sleep. So it might make you feel sleepy and reduce the time that it takes you to fall asleep. However, sleeping with alcohol in the system changes the composition of the sleep stages, so that when the alcohol wears off, you'll actually spend more time sleeping in that lighter, non-restorative stage of sleep. And alcohol sort of induced sleep can therefore not only leave you feeling vulnerable to sleep disturbance because you're in that light stage of sleep, but it can also really prevent you from feeling refreshed in the morning. And I will mention as well, vivid or sort of more bizarre dreams are also more common during that alcohol induced sleep too. We want to try and avoid napping if we can do. Napping during the day can really lower the pressure that we feel in the evening to go to sleep. It can postpone those feelings of sleepiness and can reduce the time spent in deep sleep during the night. And I think on the whole, sleeping during the day is inconsistent with our internal biological clock and can lead to sort of a more variable sleep time and quality throughout the night. I don't know if anyone's had it before where you have a little afternoon nap and then it's really difficult to get to sleep in the evening. It sort of throws your pattern all off balance. So the idea of trying to keep a sleep routine goes out the window there. We want to try and avoid stimulating activities late in the day, try and avoid them just before bedtime, really. So it might be different for people, but it could include maybe eating a meal, like a too heavy meal too late in the evening, or even if you really get into your book, reading the latest page turner might mean that it's sort of too stimulating to go to sleep. The ideal sort of activity at that time of day before bed is just to relax the body and the mind and let go of the day behind you. The point is to de-arouse yourself before you go to sleep to prevent that struggle of falling asleep. We want to keep our bedroom dark. Keeping our sleeping environment dark will sort of not only prevent sleep disruption due to the lights, but it can also affect how we sleep. So it is during the dark phase when the hormone that promotes sleep, so melatonin, is released in the brain. So lying down in a dark bedroom can really further stimulate its production and therefore ease the onset of sleep. We want to commit to a schedule. Consistent sort of bed and rising time is key for a poor sleeper and will increase the sort of predictability and the consistency of sleep. Regardless if we are someone who is a night owl or whether we're a morning person, sleeping at the right time of the day is really important just in order to get the right composition of those specific sleep stages and for all the maximum benefits that we can get. And finally, just looking at exercise. Exercise has really long been linked to better and deeper sleep. So on the flip side of that, reduced physical activity has been linked to more frequent incidents of insomnia. Aerobic exercise in particular, so practice maybe 3 times a week, has been shown to help adults with chronic insomnia by improving their sleep quality. It also helps to reduce the time to falling asleep and reducing the number of awakenings throughout the night, which is great. So really hitting 3 of those points there. I will say, however, intense aerobic exercise is discouraged too late in the day. That goes back to avoiding the stimulating activities late in the day, just because it might postpone the initiation of sleep. If we move on to the next slide, on this slide, there are just a couple of links for some further support. So the top one just shows the Bupa coronavirus hub, which is updated regularly. And there's a health and wellbeing blog as well there, which has a variety of different blog articles on it. There's some tips for exercise, mindfulness, lots of different things on there. So worth having a little look if you are curious. And then on the next slide, just a quick summary of what we've gone through today. So some of the challenges of getting a good work-life balance and some tips on how we could manage them. And then we've also just looked at sleep and how we can try and maximise that if possible. Now, that's the end of the talk today. I hope that there has been some useful information for you. What we will do now is we will have a quick look at the Q&A and just see if any questions have come through. So if you bear with me 1 second. So we've just got, I'm going to read a couple of these out. So we've got Sam, who's just said that working from home and has tried to use normal commuting time for something else. So like going for a walk or getting some jobs done to free up my weekend, and it's worked really well for them. That's absolutely great. I definitely agree that if we are working from home, it might give us an extra hour in the morning or an extra hour in the evening to fit in something exactly like that. So going for a walk, a bit of exercise, or doing some of the jobs to get them over and done with before the weekend, which is fab. We've got Sarah that said, I make sure I have my lunch break every day as I did in the office. I need structure. Yeah, I think that's a brilliant idea. I do that myself. I find that if I set a timer at the beginning of the day, so it might be an alarm clock at 12 o'clock or 1 o'clock whenever I want my lunch, and I shut my laptop, have some lunch in a different room, and then maybe try and go out for a little walk if possible, which is beneficial for me. So let's see what else we've got on here. We've got a question. So we've got, you mentioned about setting a bedtime. Is there anything else I can do to help with sleep? I don't always sleep that well. So those would be the things that I mentioned just towards the end there. So looking at those points that we mentioned, so setting a bedtime, avoiding caffeine, trying to resist any temptation to snooze, and avoiding stimulating activities late in the day. I will say something I didn't mention is that's really helped me recently is I've just bought one of those. It's like a diffuser, which is a sort of lets off a nice scent into the air, and I put lavender into it. I find that lavender really helps me to go to sleep, and you can change, it has really soothing lights on it as well, which if you pick the darkest setting, you're still in a nice dark room, but it's quite a soothing atmosphere to go to sleep to. So I don't know whether that would be beneficial looking into for yourself there. Okay, so we've got Kate, who's just said routine important, but also reduce stress levels. Absolutely. I think that's brilliant, Kate. Force yourself up at a set time, and even if you stand outside for a few minutes to breathe in fresh air and trigger your awake time. And Kate said, I have a relaxation recording happy to send for using each evening, which is great. I think that's really, really good idea there. Force yourself up at a set time and then just standing outside to get a bit of that fresh air. I think at the moment, as we're probably inside a lot more, it can be really easy to sort of forget that we need to get that sunlight and that fresh air to keep us going. So we've got a couple of other tips here that people are sending in. Again, we've got someone saying they use an eye mask, which is great, and also getting bedroom as cold as possible. So there is research that says we want to lower our body temperature just ever so slightly before we go to sleep, and that might help us get to sleep instead of being in a really hot environment. We've got a question here that says, what might I notice in a friend or colleague that may not have work-life balance right? So I think this probably goes back to a couple of things that I said at the beginning, sort of being aware of the signs of work-related stress. Often work friends or colleagues, or friends might not tell us that they're not getting that good balance. It's not always the easiest thing to talk about. What it might mean is if you do have any worries about anybody, try and ask them, make sure that you check in with them, make sure that you are happy to just see that they're okay. If they're aware that you're sort of just looking out for them, they might be a little bit more likely to open up. I think if people haven't got that right work-life balance, maybe finding it a bit more hard to concentrate might not be as positive as they usually are. I think just looking for any changes in your friends or your work colleagues, and if you are worried, just ask them how they're doing. Try not to be too nosy, but hopefully they will open up to you if they know that you genuinely are interested in their health. Okay, so we've got a couple more comments here. Bex has said that there's a setting on your phone called night shift on iPhone, and it shifts the colour of the screen away from the blue light towards the red light to reduce the strain on your eyes before you go to sleep. And that's made a huge difference for Bex. I use that as well. I think it's brilliant. I think on an Android, it's blue light filter, it's called, and you can turn the blue light filter on closer to bedtime. And it does just change that towards the red rather than the blue, and the strain can go down there. Now, we've just come to the end of the talk, really. So there's a couple of questions that I might not get round to answering. But thank you so much for all your hints and tips that you have I've put on the question and answer there. It's really, really good. I think really beneficial for people to share how they're coping and what works for them, because one thing that works for one person might not work for the other. So as much information as we've got, I think, is brilliant. What I will say is we will put a link in the Q&A. So if there is any feedback that you've got, we really appreciate you sending that in. And thanks very much, everyone, for listening today. Thanks.